makes it special playing here in Chicago is the people. Could have been topped off better than playing with Chicago Bears, one of the originals.
The Bears was a great football franchise. Hopefully, we helped them make a great football franchise.
Once in a generation or a lifetime, the great runner arrives in pro football. He is one of the select few who can fill stadiums Sunday after Sunday and whose number is burned into the memory of every fan.
His nine-year career stands apart as the single most sustained work of devastation ever committed on a football field by anyone, anywhere, anytime.
When Gale Sayers and Dick Butkus joined the Bears in 1965, the two future Hall of Famers took the Windy City by storm. On the surface, this mauler and this magician were a study in contrasts.
They provided an incredible yin and yang. Butkus, you got this great brutality. From Sayers, you got grace.
In this city, they represented, kind of like the Carl Sandburg poem, different parts of Chicago. This gust of breeze, this beautiful wind, the beautiful lake in Gale Sayers. The tough guys on the south side. And Dick Butkus, you take that, you know, you just switch around, you've got kick butt.
But looking deeper, they shared a common bond that's lasted a lifetime, beginning with their hard-scrabble childhoods.
See that? Yeah, nice people, aren't they?
Butkus was born here in Chicago on December 9th, 1942. He was the youngest of nine children. His parents, Lithuanian immigrants, lived on the city's south side.
There she is. There she lies.
That's the estate.
That is the estate.
The estate.
You know, he had to be tough because he was the last one. You know, and he had to fight for all little things.
All the Butkus brothers? I thought it was the Dalton gang.
And they, for a couple summers, had a thing called Butkus Brothers Moving Company.
And if you didn't agree with them...
Yeah, they'd take the furniture and put it over the top of your head.
That became your problem.
And there's Dick, you know, the little guy. Hey, Putz, can you carry the icebreaker or can you carry the chair at least?
I've never seen this picture before. That's nice.
This is a mother and my father. See how small he is? He's very small.
Gale was born in Kansas and then moved to Omaha. His dad was, you know, common laborer.
They moved from one neighborhood to the other in what he now realizes was a ghetto. If his father made 50 cents more an hour, they were moving as a family.
I felt that I had to do something to get us out of this situation.
Gale, like so many athletes, found an outlet in sports.
Dick plotted out his future when he was a young boy.
But I would get the Skippy jar, an empty Skippy jar, and then kick. So I kicked to here, and then I got better, and I kicked to here. And, you know, I'd come out here and work out, and at night I'd run around and dodge trees and stuff.
I mean, how many people know where their future lies when they are 8, 9, 10 years old?
You know, when I was in grade school, high school, and college, I've always wanted to be a professional football player.
If I didn't do a good job playing football, I couldn't get a scholarship to go to college.
While Sayers starred as a running back and linebacker in Omaha, Butkus played the same positions at Chicago Vocational School.
Just as soon as he got here, we knew he had something special. Defense was definitely his specialty, and it stood out. You could tell almost from the beginning that he was something that you haven't seen before.
He was the hardest hitter. He never missed a tackle. He took them to the city championship every year that he was on the varsity.
Sayers' talents took him to Kansas University.
Gale Sayers of Kansas earned his place as All-America halfback by providing the
all these stars in the sky. And I thought of a comet. Kansas Comet.
Against Nebraska, Sayers takes off from the 1 yard line and streaks 99 yards. It was the longest run from scrimmage in Kansas history. When a team zooms from eighth place in its conference to near the top in one season, there must be a reason. And one of the pivotal players in Illinois' revival is the earnest young amateur photographer, Dick Butkus. The subject is his bride of a few months.
I could hear what other people would say about him, and they didn't know who I was, but it was always good.
Dick sparked Illinois to the 1963 Big Ten title, and a victory over Washington in the Rose Bowl. Nobody tackles harder or more often than Butkus. Illinois coach Pete Elliott says Butkus lives for that heavy contact on Saturday afternoon.
It was inevitable that these two stars would cross paths.
Now, once again, we are privileged to present to the country the All-Americans picked by the football coaches of the country. Right half, Gale Sayers, University of Kansas, comes from Omaha. At center, Dick Butkus comes from the University of Illinois from Chicago.
That's where they say Butkus. So maybe Ed Sullivan had a little Lithuanian in him. I don't know.
Bears made history when they brought the duo together. When Chicago traded for the Steelers' first-round selection, they seized the opportunity to draft two of the greatest players ever with consecutive picks.
The greatest draft in the history of football was 1965.
Is there one better?
And again, two of the best football players in the history of the game.
We're talking the best of the best.
In one draft.
On the same team.
In 1 year, 3 and 4.
That's unheard of.
Never happened again.
That was an easy question.
When we return.
I played against him every day in practice. Watch out for him, because he's going to knock your ass off.
If these guys had come into the league in 2014 the way they did in 1965, they would be the biggest thing ever. They would make LeBron James look like some bum off the street.
George Halas's Bears had won the NFL championship just 2 years earlier in 1963. For the skilled but shy Sayers, it would take a while to be fully accepted.
Looked at this guy and said, well, you know, we've seen a lot of scat backs come through training camp over the years and highly celebrated. Gale felt that he had to prove to these veterans that he was the real deal.
I wasn't thinking about, oh, Christ, we're going to win the championship again because Gale and I are coming here. It was quite the opposite. A lot of the veterans made that known. You wouldn't sit with them. You'd have to sit over somewhere else, and you'd hear them. They'd be laughing about it. So I just used all that. We'll see. You know, we'll see who's going to be laughing last.
Sayers and Butkus formed a friendship that lasts to this day. But back in 65, they were fierce rivals.
That move of his, and he was gone. You never got a good shot at him. Christ, that ought to be a cakewalk against anybody else. And you know something? It turned out to be the truth.
I played against him every day in practice. There's nobody, no one, as tough as Dick Butkus. The only advice that Coach Halas gave to me, watch out for him, because he's going to knock your ass off.
Get ready for Dick Butkus, football's doomsday machine. A special kind of man who turns ball carriers into blood and flesh tackling dummies.
When you talk about 1965 NFL rookies, here's a man you can't forget. He's Gale Sayers of the Chicago Bears, a runner extraordinary.
They both came in kind of like shooting stars with this great immediate impact. And they came in at a time when the rest of the NFL really didn't know how to handle them because they were new. So they were immediately at the height of their abilities.
In 1965, NFL Rookie of the Year honors quickly became a two-man race. Butkus staked his claim by leading the team in tackles, interceptions, forced fumbles, and fumbles recovered. Sayers won the award, however, with 22 touchdowns, a rookie record that still stands. wins in 8 of their next 9. Playoff hopes were still alive when they faced the 49ers in December.
The day of the game, very, very rainy, and I don't like to play in wet weather because anything can happen. You can slip and pull a muscle. There's so many things that you can't do on a wet day. But that particular day, everything went right for Gale Sayers. Seemed like everything I did was right. The 49ers were slipping, the rest of the Bears were slipping, but Gale just walked through everybody.
With that game just 2 minutes old and the field slick from rain, Gale Sayers sprints past the prospectors for an 80-yard screen pass touchdown run.
The greatest performance in the National Football League history was that performance, and you had to be there to see it, but when you're on the field and part of it, it was even more exciting, believe me.
This game is based on transcendent players. There's some guys, some players who just stand above. They're not in the same universe with him. It gives you chills because you actually become part of, it's like you're riding on his back and I can't be stopped. Other guys, you may be NFL players, but you're just clowns. You're just highway cones for this guy to run around.
After his 5th touchdown, Sayers was taken out. But late in the game, he and Butkus were sent back in on the punt return team.
You know, they moved.
Chicago to wins in 8 of their next 9. Playoff hopes were still alive when they faced the 49ers in December.
The day of the game, very, very rainy, and I don't like to play in wet weather because anything can happen. You can slip and pull a muscle. There's so many things that you can't do on a wet day. But that particular day, everything went right for Gale Sayers. Seemed like everything I did was right. The 49ers were slipping, the rest of the Bears were slipping, but Gale just walked through everybody.
With that game just 2 minutes old and the field slick from rain, Gale Sayers sprints past the prospectors for an 80-yard screen pass touchdown run.
The greatest performance in the National Football League history was that performance, and you had to be there to see it, but when you're on the field and part of it, it was even more exciting, believe me.
This game is based on transcendent players. There's some guys, some players who just stand above. They're not in the same universe with him. It gives you chills because you actually become part of. It's like you're riding on his back and I can't be stopped. All you other guys, you may be NFL players, but you're just clowns. You're just highway cones for this guy to run around.
After his 5th touchdown, Sayers was taken out. But late in the game, he and Butkus were sent back in on the punt return team.
You know, they moved me from, you know, the center guy of the 5 up front. That was my job. And then I'd try to block him, and then I'd circle around. A lot of times I banged into him coming back this way. I'm trying to peel off. So then they moved me out of there, get his ass out of there, and get him back in the wedge.
Every time I went out there for a punt return or a kickoff return, hey, I'm going to get some yards. Simple as that. To me, it wasn't a problem. It's, hey, kick me the ball, please.
Saying goes, you ain't seen nothing yet. Watch it now. Sayers, NFL Rookie of the Year. A one-man Gale. Dashing 85 dazzling yards on the longest punt return of the season. Here he is, galloping Gale, carrying the mail. This is his 6th touchdown of the game.
On the film, you can see me like 20 yards behind him watching. There was nobody around, no one blocked. It just blew right through everybody. What got me was when the offense got down to the 2-yard line, and they pulled Gale and put a jar on it. He
should have scored 7.
For him, it would have been great to see.
If I scored 15 touchdowns, hey, it wouldn't be for me, it's for the team. For a good football game, you know. And I did my thing.
On the same day that Sayers scored 6 touchdowns in the mud, the Packers' Paul Hornung scored 5 in a Baltimore fog. Green Bay won the division. In what would become a dismal and frustrating pattern, Butkus and Sayers missed the playoffs.
Line up in at 56. Stack, Baker, Burn, Blitz. Let's go now. Watch the play action. Let's go.
Are you as mean as you look in the films?
Well, it depends what films you're looking at.
Pass! Oh, no! God!
Son of a... Everybody thinks I'm this nasty guy, and it wasn't really me.
With his hands, he's, you know, crazy.
He wanted to twist him as if he could snap that person in half, take it over to the sidelines and drop it in the garbage can. He got 4 personal fouls in one game. Now, you're either just really mad about something, or you really don't know what a personal foul is, or you really don't care.
Where are you getting all this information?
Dick was an animal. I call him a maniac, a stone maniac.
And I could hear Dick.
Hold him up! Hold him up!
Because Dick wants to come there and crack him. He just loved to crush people.
When I was in training camp, when he tried to burn my door down, which he still denies. I think he also put the raccoon in my room.
Did you ever hit a guy out of bounds?
Momentum, maybe.
Did you ever give a guy a little extra?
Yep.
Did you ever spit on Mick Tinglehoff's hands?
No way. I spit on the ball.
Did you ever bite an opposing player?
I think it's just another one of those stories. Grows after the years, you know.
I didn't bite him. Zonka didn't bite him. The only guy left was Butkus. He denies it today.
Did you ever call a guy and ask?
Maybe. Everybody thinks so. You're so mean and everything else. I hit a ball.
While Butkus was often considered an ogre, Sayers was seen as an oddity.
This guy ran the way nobody'd ever run before. He was able to stop and start as a tall man, not a 5'8" guy, but as a magnificent running specimen.
You ever see those Jesus lizards that walk on water? That was Gale Sayers.
I loved watching him run. Like going to the theater, it was like watching ballet. Seemed to be this person that partly on the ground, but just partly suspended. Watching him run was one of the most beautiful experiences I've ever had in my life.
And it's kind of wrong to call him a weapon because he was prettier than a weapon. It was like a beautiful 4th of July celebration in the sky as opposed to some mortar just coming over and blowing things up. His running style, and this man running, is just a thing of beauty.
The comet was dazzling. Butkus was violent. But both were far more than that.
You didn't talk about the interceptions he made or the way he could drop in the coverage or all those things. He was a complete football player. But what people remember about him was this. It was the contact part of it.
There was a method to Butkus's madness.
I felt that I had to make every tackle.
I'm not trying to knock people out for, you know, so I can jump up and, you know, pound my chest and everything. I would try to hit your throat with my head and wrap up high. Because somewhere along the line, they're going to start thinking about, if they see me coming, they're going to start thinking, oh, I got to get ready for this blow. Just maybe they'll forget about the ball. Now, there must be a reason why I led the league in recovering fumbles for the longest time until Jim Marshall, who played 48 years, beat my record.
Gale Sayers was not only a runner like no other, he was a superb receiver. To be sure, Butkus could fill a hole, but he also covered backs and tight ends deep. Sayers was a true triple threat, runner, receiver, and passer. Both were standouts on special teams, Butkus as a blocker, and even receiver on a busted play. Sayers set records as a punt and kick returner, but it wasn't enough. Both men shared another similarity. They never got to display their many skills in a playoff game.
Being a loser is no fun. I'm so mad when we lose that I wouldn't tell her anyway. And sometimes I think, you know, what have I really done after it's all over?
After a loss, forget it. Don't open your mouth. He's so dedicated. Like, why can't he be on a championship team just once before he's finished?
Every time I went to Rensselaer training camp, I thought we were going to win. I honestly thought we would win. And in order for that to happen, is that I would have to, and I was going to play my ass off. It just it worked out where we didn't have that good of teams. What am I going to do? What can I say? But it doesn't mean that I had to fail. You know, it's easy to quit, and I just would never quit.
Butkus and Sayers were cheated. They were cheated. They were cheated because they were not put ball players around them. They expected Butkus and Sayers to take them to the championship. You can't do that. Shame on the Chicago Bears. Shame on them. You've got Dick Butkus and Gale Sayers in 65, Rookie of the Year, Hall of Famers, and you couldn't get those two guys to the playoffs? Are you kidding me? Shame on you.
Space out here, so we just spend a lot of time at home. Lately, I've got a little motorcycle, a little scrambler that I drive the kids around on the back.
Do you remember it?
I remember it. Oh, yeah.
Sitting on the gas tank, holding on to that bar. I remember being the toddler wrestling around. The other one would scramble up and try to pinch his nose.
I think the greatest misconception about my father is how he is at home, how he played.
When people would say, oh, your dad's mean, I'm like, who are you talking about?
While there was peace at home, on the field, the Bears were a mess.
1968 was a season of highs and lows for the Bears. An impressive preseason record, but a faltering start with only one victory in the first five games.
Again, the only two bright spots were Butkus and Sayers.
Gale Sayers, the superstar. He cuts, weaves, stops, and goes. He runs with power and precision. This is the eye of... Said it was calm. Never has met Dick Butkus.
Butkus continued to dominate on defense. And Sayers was on track for his best season ever.
Gale Sayers ran for 205 yards on 24 carries. A new Bears single-game rushing record.
On November 10th, 1968, Sayers ran 49 toss left, a play he'd run hundreds of times before.
Everything stopped. The whole world stopped. I felt it myself inside. Oh no, of all people, dear God, not this guy, not this guy.
He planted his leg, Kermit Alexander hit it.
He went down for the knee like you're blocking somebody. And that's when he hit that shoulder pad, he hit that knee. That was it.
You could tell the way he ran with abandon, he wasn't protecting himself.
Mm-hmm.
just the sheer forces of physics, something was going to happen.
Gale was down for quite a while. Tried to get up, couldn't support himself. He passed out while he's being taken off the field.
His craft, in which he depended on his legs for his livelihood, is similar to a surgeon losing his eye. These are magical pistons enabled him to do what nobody else could do, and then all of a sudden, this is threatened.
Hey, doctor, is it Gale? I can fix this, and just trust me.
You know, knee surgery is pretty primitive back then. Guys going in there a little more than carpenters. Hey, sure, let's see. Let's chisel this out. Let's hammer this. Let's saw that. Hey, how about a screw here? He was never the original naive, innocent child, if you will, after that moment.
Sometimes I cry about it because I didn't get a chance to play the game. And I wish they would give me, I wish they had better doctors back then.
Gale Sayers first arrived at the Bears training camp back in 65. He wasn't the only rookie running back. Also there was a fullback from Wake Forest named Brian Piccolo. Gale and Pick quickly bonded and became roommates. Their friendship was immortalized in the movie Brian Song.
Gale Sayers.
Yeah?
Hey, Brian Piccolo. Met up in Buffalo in that All-American game last June.
Yeah, sorry I didn't remember. I'm not very good at that kind of stuff.
By 1969, the two had become inseparable. They supported and challenged each other. Piccolo pushed Sayers to the limit during the tough rehab of Gale's rebuilt knee.
Seven. Get it up. Eight. Oh, yeah, man. Chicken.
Oh, man. Don't make me laugh, please.
You know, we were always dealing with race relationships, certainly. And that seems to be ongoing. It never seems to stop. For a moment, all of that just disappeared. I think they were so deeply touched by the whole relationship that we had between each other. It was a wonderful love story between two men.
Sayers had some lingering doubts about his knee as the 69 season approached. Butkus had none. He was in prime shape for his finest season ever. Little did they know that it would be the worst season in Bears history. Sayers' longest run was just 28 yards, but by season's end, he battled his way to his second rushing title.
It's remarkable that in 1969, that Gale was able to come back off the knee injury and basically sort of reinvent his style because he knew that he could not run the same way laterally that he used to.
It showed his resilience, it showed his determination, it showed his toughness. It let you know that Gale Sayers wasn't just some physical freak who can do something with his body that no one else can do. It was about heart with him too. And I think that season defined him as well as any season he ever played.
The Bears won just one game in 1969, yet incredibly, Dick Butkus was the NFL Defensive Player of the Year. linebacker Doug Buffone, number 55, witnessed Butkus's destruction firsthand.
I remember saying this to myself, thank God that he was on my side. I never saw anybody like this in my life. Just had that attitude. You know what? I'm going to go on that field, I'm going to rip your face off. To tackle him, he didn't want them to get up. That's how hard he wanted to hit. He just kept banging him. I said, gee.
I've never seen a person that intense, that vicious on every damn play that he was in there. I mean, come on. And I remember he said, when he'd knock a guy down on the ground, he wanted the guy to look at him, because he looked right back at him and, look who put your ass on the ground. I'm serious.
The 1-13 season was a nightmare. But for Brian Piccolo, it was a dream come true. He had become the starting fullback and was playing alongside Sayers. Late in the year, however, Piccolo felt weak and had to take himself out of a game. He went to New York City for an examination. Soon after, Sayers learned that Piccolo had cancer.
He fought his butt off. But, you know, he got a disease that he couldn't conquer.
When I get you next train, Ken, when I get you.
I think to this day, when you bring up Brian Piccolo's name, he gets emotional and he thinks about what an impact Brian had on his life and helping him put in perspective what courage is all about. That it's not all about the touchdowns and the glory, but something much stronger.
Brian Piccolo died on June 16th, 1970. He was 26. Butkus and Sayers were pallbearers.
And just a super young man. And I'll never forget him. And always had a joke. And I will never, ever forget him.
This song to Rocky's Bulldog Butkus.
Both is a red and Vitus is blue.
From poets.
If you got any sense, you'll keep Butkus away from you.
To podcasts.
In the morning, I watch Gale Sayers' best runs, and then I start writing. And I swear to God, it makes my writing better.
Wow! And from painters to Papa Bear.
Gale Sayers, magic in motion, will not only help make our dream come true, but also who captured my heart.
On a stormy Chicago night in 1994, the team's own Thunder and Lightning had their numbers retired together.
Rain coming down sideways, wind howling. I think it was symbolic. You know, you've got some forces of nature just can't be contained, like Butkus and Sayers.
Dick and I, we developed a great, great friendship. I couldn't ask for anything else better.
Dick Butkus, we go back a long time together.
It was funny, if we were at home watching the game on television, he'd always say, get out the tape, tape my ankles. He said, I'm ready to play. Everything about it, he loved that game that much that he would do it all over again.
Look at her. Look at her.
He achieved everything he wanted to achieve in his football life. He did it all, and he loved it. The harder the hit, the better he liked it.